It's a bird. It's a plane. It's an Eddie Lacy sighting. Yay! Finally, another top five draft pick comes up big, this time on Thursday Night Football. And Calvin Johnson is back in practice. Are we ready to trust him again, or does the sting from last week keep him as a guy that we're worried about heading into week five? We got our busts and sleepers of the week, and we'll answer your questions here on today's episode of the Fantasy Football Swagger Podcast. What's up, everybody? Welcome to the Fantasy Football Swagger Podcast. My name is Nick, also known as Clickwood, and I am joined, as always, by my partner in crime, Dustin, or Project KSL. And Dustin, Thursday Night Football, we talked about this one on our other show a couple of days ago. Mm-hmm. We were not expecting this to be a complete blowout. We were a little bit wrong on that. Eddie Lacy is back. 105 yards, two touchdowns, 27 yards receiving, but only 13 carries. Are you worried about that at all?
They were giving James Starks some carries too throughout that most of that game too. So I mean, there might be a little bit more of a timeshare there than I think a lot of people thought. But you'd still assume he gets most of the goal line duties. But I don't know. Like I still think I wasn't that hot on Eddie Lacy to begin with, so it's kind of hard for me to get lower. But for what it was, I mean, it was a good week for him, I guess. But it doesn't look like the Vikings were prepared at all to play any game whatsoever. So. I mean, take
yeah,
for what you
I
want.
Mean, James Starks did only touch the ball 12 times, so I'm not really that overly worried about it.
12 to 13, though. Didn't you say Lacy had 13 carries?
I did, but like I mean, 50, here's 50. It is, but here's the thing. That's a good point. However, I think the bigger situation here is the fact that they were up 28-0 at what, the end of the first quarter.
I mean, fair enough.
I don't think they're going to trot Eddie Lacy out there to get 30 carries in a game that they're winning by that much. So, I mean, to me, I look at it as more of a situational thing. I don't see James Starks getting a 50-50 split or even like a 30-70 split. I think it's going to be 80-20 going forward. Yeah, I do still think Eddie Lacy is the guy there. Like you said, the goal line work is going to go to Edward Lacy. And I mean, with that being said, I still think he's a first-round pick if we're redrafting. I mean, maybe a low-end pick, but I still think he's a top five, top eight running back. I mean, this is the kind of game you saw the explosion that he has. You see the type of moves that he can make, well, I mean, and he's going to get those touchdowns.
You can say that, but I also saw him the first 3 weeks, and he was a complete shitter. So,
yeah.
I mean, you can use this 1 week and act like he's been it all for the whole season, but he did score duds in one game. Yeah,
he did score in his third game, so I'm not overly concerned about that.
Grace, so he moved the TD. Yeah. I mean, he had a complete dud again.
But that's the whole reason that I drafted Eddie Lacy, because I expected him to get 10 to 12 touchdowns this year.
I mean, fair enough. And even if you get 10 or 12 TDs, you're only getting 40 yards a game. You're not worth that first
He's not going to get 40 yards a game. Come on.
He was getting that around the first four games.
Okay, so, I mean, if he's getting 40 yards a game, that means that you think he's going to finish with less than 800 yards on the year.
Do that, but
Okay, that's what I'm saying. Going forward, Eddie Lacy's going to do better than that. We have to assume he's going to get 75 yards at least per game.
But you have to put it in perspective of saying, okay, this dude is only getting this amount of carries. He's only put this many yards up. He had this one game versus the Vikings, which is a complete shit show. Let's not act like that's been the norm.
No, it's not been the norm. If it was the norm, he would be the number one overall player.
Yeah, I mean, obviously. But I'm just saying, I think we have to put a little bit more into the perspective that he has had three bad fantasy games as opposed to one good game.
He's had two bad fantasy games, one solid fantasy game, and one great fantasy game.
What did he get in the solid game, a 10?
I think like a 13. He had like, what, 50 yards, like two or three receptions, and then a touchdown. So, I mean, you put that into context, and I mean, yeah, it's not a great game, but I mean, that's not the reason you lose.
I mean,
yeah,
I
understand. Your first two games, not good. But again, we're talking about going forward. And I think Eddie Lacy is a solid player going forward. I'm not overly concerned about him. I do still think that he's a guy that you're having in your lineup on a week-to-week basis. Yeah. Just given the fact that the running back position has been such a crapshoot this year. Not just in Green Bay. Not just with the other top first-round picks, because there's been a ton of them that have been a complete joke. I mean, you look at LeSean McCoy, and he's had worse games than Eddie Lacy. You look at Jamal Charles, he missed basically the first 3 weeks of the season. I mean, so now we look at it, and it's like, okay. And then, obviously, Adrian Peterson's been out.
No,
so,
but I just took exception to you saying he'd be a first-round pick in a redraft. I don't agree with that at all.
I think he's right up there. I mean, given the fact that there's so many other train wrecks at the running back position.
I mean, yeah, running backs, but I'm just saying I think there's enough other players out there. I mean, if you look at DeMarco Murray, you're definitely taking ahead of him.
Le'Veon Bell.
Yep. Nate Manning, Jamal Charles, Jimmy Graham.
Jimmy Graham.
Gio probably Bernard, still, LeSean McCoy.
Probably still Matt a Forte. Calvin. Maybe not Calvin, though. I mean, like, it's...
Rashad Jennings, Andrew Luck, Julius Thomas.
I'm not taking Rashad Jennings above him. Not taking Andrew Luck above him. Not taking Julius Thomas above him. I'm not saying that I don't like those guys, but
that puts him at nine. But even then, I think he's those guys.
I think he's a low end first round pick for redrafting right now. Still easily a top 10 running back. So going forward, I mean, I don't think you can name 10 running backs that are better than Eddie Lacy.
Going forward, that I'd rather have.
Nah,
I think I could.
We'll have to maybe think about that then. Maybe we can. You want to try naming them right now?
I don't think I could have 10 off the top of my head. I could probably name like 7 off the top of my head. I'd rather have though.
Rashad Jennings
would be one of them. So.
Yeah, Rashad Jennings is, I think, the one that I would kind of teeter on. And then everybody below Rashad Jennings is, to me, is not close. So, I mean, to me, he's still a guy that you're taking right around probably where you were taking a guy like DeMarco Murray to start the season. So, I mean, to me, I like Eddie Lacy going forward. I think he's an every week must start pretty much regardless of the matchup, just given the fact that he can get into the end zone unlike so many of the other running backs.
I think you should wait and see a little bit more. Green Bay offense looked like ass in that one game. And even New England shit offense styled on Minnesota's defense. I think we should
Fair enough. But let's talk a little bit more about Green Bay's offense, because Aaron Rodgers looked good in limited work, really. And, I mean, obviously a lot of that came from the fact, again,
passes.
Yeah, they were up 28-0 at the end of the first quarter or early in the second quarter. So, I mean, you don't expect Aaron Rodgers to be out there tossing it around, getting six touchdowns or anything.
Sure. He was pulled early, yeah.
But, I mean, and not even just pulled, but, like, you know, then they started to give the ball to James Starks and John Kuhn. And, like, you know, it's like...
They're grinding the game out at that point, sure.
It is what it is on that. But, I mean, he put up a marginal, solid Aaron Rodgers game, given the fact that he did have the three TDs. But, I mean, you look at these type of situations, and it's like...
18 points is a good day.
It's a solid fantasy game, no question about it. No one's complaining about an 18-point fantasy day. So, I mean, Aaron Rodgers, I think you were still, like, we talked about this going into this game on our previous podcast, that I still believe that Aaron Rodgers is a guy that I'm selling high on right now, because I don't expect them to have many games like this one where they're just crushing a team. And, I mean, I think that if you put Aaron Rodgers on, let's say, 32 to 35 touchdowns this year, I don't think that necessarily puts him that far ahead of a guy like a Ben Roethlisberger or an Eli Manning or, you know, those kind of guys. Yeah. I'm not saying I wouldn't take Aaron Rodgers above them by any means. I certainly would.
Just comparatively.
The value, though, that you get between the two is not that significant. Whereas you can still trade Aaron Rodgers, I think, especially after two good games where he's thrown 7 touchdowns in 2 weeks. People are going to be looking at Aaron Rodgers being that guy that they would have taken in the first round. So I think that you can trade him potentially for a guy whose value may be a little bit lower, you know, somebody like a LeSean McCoy, for example, right? I mean, these kind of guys that have started off kind of slow, and maybe you can try and buy low on one of them, give up Aaron Rodgers, and then still, you know, boost your team up by still having a solid quarterback like an Andy Dalton, a Ben Roethlisberger, an Eli Manning, something like that.
Yeah, I mean, we all felt the same way about Aaron Rodgers. I mean, yeah, we obviously like him, but do we like him comparatively to other guys?
That's the real question. So I'm not exactly sure what I do with Aaron Rodgers. I mean, like I said, I think I'm still trading him.
If you have to hold on to him, you're not in a bad situation as a thing.
Right.
It's not like, oh, my God, abandon Aaron Rodgers. But
No.
If you can get something to significantly improve your team and still have a quarterback, like you said, a Jay Cutler, Ben Roethlisberger, whoever, then, you probably make that move.
This is not and was never an abandoned ship on Aaron Rodgers. It was always a matter of getting value for him. There's never any player in fantasy football, period, at any point where I would never trade them. Doesn't matter. Peyton Manning's season last year, he's thrown 55 touchdowns. There is still a deal out there in a scenario where I would trade for Peyton Manning away.
Yeah, I mean, no one's ever untouchable generally. But
And that's kind of the thing that I think people don't sometimes understand. Like, why would you trade this guy? He just had a good game. Like, yeah, but you have to think he's going to – his numbers – he's not going to throw 7 touchdowns over 2 games every week.
Peyton Manning's going to have – what might be a pretty close to – exception to that, though, with that season he had last year, though.
I mean, just a monster season, obviously. Yeah, you talk about guys like LaDainian Tomlinson when they were scoring 30 touchdowns in a season with 2,000 yards.
If you had Tomlinson on your team that year, you won, and that's the end of the discussion.
Right. Right. But I mean, but in those kind of scenarios, though, there were always the potential trades where you give up a guy like a Tomlinson and you receive a Randy Moss and a Larry Johnson in return.
Sean
if you did that,
three of them or something.
Yeah. And I mean, in those type of scenarios, you give up LaDainian Tomlinson because you're getting such value in return. And that's kind of what I'm
You'll
saying with Aaron Rodgers.
Yeah.
Right. Yep. Exactly. So let's talk about the other side of the football. Minnesota Vikings offense without Teddy Bridgewater, without Matt Cassel, they had to start Christian Ponder this week, and that was just a complete train wreck. Nobody had expectations for Christian Ponder into this one or anything, but I mean, were you surprised to see the Vikings offense look that incompetent against a pretty mediocre Green Bay defense?
No, because I mean, going into the season, everyone knew it was no big secret that the offense was completely built around Adrian Peterson.
Right.
And the fact that Peterson hasn't been there for a while now. I mean, Asiata is clearly not Adrian Peterson. Jared McKinnon is not Adrian Peterson. Christian Ponder is flat out god awful. Cordarrelle Patterson is hurt. Kyle Rudolph is out. I mean, they've been banged up. They're without their best player on offense. So, I mean, no, it's not a huge surprise. I don't think the Green Bay defense is, like, really good all of a sudden or anything. I still think they're ass. But I think it might just be one of those situations like we saw with Atlanta and Tampa, whatever it was, last week or the week before that, or 2 weeks ago, excuse me, where it was just like, oh man, Atlanta's defense really coming through, but they're not that good. Green Bay's defense isn't that good.
Right.
It was just one of those games. All the wheels fell off early. The team quit, you know, and those games happen and you move on. But
yeah,
going forward, I think Teddy Bridgewater will be much better for them offensively for like a team perspective week to week.
Yeah, to me, it really comes down to, you know, you've got Teddy Bridgewater, who is more athletic than any of the other quarterbacks that they have on the team. And I think that brings a different dynamic to the offense because they're really based on running the football. Like you said, going into the year, that was what they built their team around. And they don't really have great down the field targets. Now, everybody's going to talk about how, you know, Cordarrelle Patterson should be that guy, but that really hasn't developed. We haven't seen that with anybody. I'm not overly optimistic about any of the receivers in this offense, especially now that Kyle Rudolph is injured. I had pretty high expectations for him going into the year, but you know, all these other guys, I'm not super excited about. I've mentioned a few times now, I think Cordarrelle Patterson is probably one of the most overrated players right now, and I would be willing to trade him for just about anything of value, to be completely honest with you. That week one situation where he ran for a touchdown completely masks the fact that he has done nothing else throughout the entire year. So I look at this offense and I think you're right. I don't see any way that Teddy Bridgewater doesn't make a major improvement for them. I like their offense better as a whole with Teddy Bridgewater on the field, and I especially like their running situation with him on the field because the defense is going to have to account for him, not just being you know, a pure runner, but like I think he's a better passer than any of those guys
against
as well.
Them more or as much as they would against a batter or a worse quarterback.
Exactly, and when they run these play fakes, and I'm not expecting them to run read options or anything like that, but the defense has to account for him a lot more than they do Christian Ponder, Matt Cassel.
Yeah,
so
obviously.
My question is for you. We see Matt Asiata and Jerick McKinnon's situation this week, and obviously it was a blowout game, so it's a little bit of a difference, but Asiata touched the ball 15 times, McKinnon 10 times. I mean, do we have anything that we can pull from that at all? I mean, are you liking McKinnon a little bit more after this game? Are you liking Asiata anymore? What do you think?
I mean, it's so tough to really gauge in a throwaway game like this where the Vikings knew they were out of it after like the first quarter.
Right.
You know, it's so tough to gauge what their true interest should be in a close game and a game that they're up. It's so hard. It's almost you just throw the whole game out and just like you move on.
Right.
So I it doesn't change my opinion on either one of them. I still think Asiata is probably the better guy to own for the time being, even though I do like Jerick McKinnon. But I mean, if there's a receiver to own when Teddy Bridgewater gets back, I think it'll probably be Jairus Wright. As crazy as that sounds.
True. Because I like Jairus Wright better too.
Yeah, I mean,
we talked a little bit about that in our previous show. I think Jairus Wright definitely showed that he has comfort with Teddy Bridgewater. He caught a bunch of passes from Bridgewater. So to me, I think that the overall, like if we're redrafting right now, I think Cordarrelle Patterson's probably still going ahead of him just because of the raw physical skill.
Yeah, I mean, he's a better player. That's the thing,
Right, exactly. I think the high-end potential is better for him, but I would not be surprised at all if Jairus Wright outscores him for the remainder of the year.
Yeah, I wouldn't really be surprised. I mean, Cordarrelle Patterson's hurt, like I said, too, right now.
Yeah.
He's nursing a rib, so, I mean,
he would have been my bust of the week again if these guys were playing on Sunday. I mean, I just don't see what there is to like about a guy that's getting targeted four times a game.
It's just the talent. I mean, I think people are eventually you just hope that the talent will take over because he's an insanely talented guy.
Yeah.
But, you know, if he can't get the ball in his hands, then what are you going to do? So
maybe the Vikings need to look at what Seattle's doing with Percy Harvin, or at least what they did, and give him some carries out of the backfield, design some plays.
He's just one of those players that, whether it be receptions, returning, whatever, you have to get the ball in his hands. So you find ways to just get him the ball in space and say go. Because, I mean, that dude glides. Like, straight up, there's very few runners that have as much just natural talent in the open field as he does. He just straight up glides. So,
but until we see it produce into fantasy numbers, I mean, he's got to be on your bench going forward.
Oh, yeah, you're not starting him unless you're in a bad situation.
Right. So let's move on to Sunday's games, and we have the return of Calvin Johnson. Now, I say the return because he played this past week, and yes, he's still going to be probably a game-time decision, it sounds like, but... I mean, we look at what he did this past week. He caught 2 passes for 12 yards, the lowest total that he's ever had in a game that the Lions won. Are you concerned about Calvin Johnson right now?
I am for this week. If I have other options this week, I'm not playing him, because last week he basically didn't play. I know he had 2 catches, but basically he might as well not even play. He was an act. I mean, he was just a decoy the whole game. I mean, he was limping around the whole time. So the fact that the Lions are comfortable even knowing that he's damn near too hurt to even walk to still dress him, that's concerning for fantasy. Because they say he's a game-time decision this week, and there's no indication that he's really gotten a lot better because he still hasn't really practiced. He practiced today on a super limited workload. Caldwell said he's going to be a game-time decision, so that doesn't look good for his ankle. And they said that unless there's progress with his ankle over the next 2 days, he's not going to play. So even if he does, you wonder how limited it'll be. For this week, again, it really seems like they just need to sit him out for this week, maybe the next one too, and just let the ankle heal. Because there's no sense in just keep trotting him out there on a bum ankle.
I mean, that's a good point, because you look at some of these guys that they continue to try and trot out there every single week and they never fully recover. And
Roddy White last year, prime example.
Exactly. I was actually going to point that out. Yeah, I mean, these guys, you could see them actually be healthy if they just got a week off. And it sucks for a Calvin Johnson owner, but what sucks even worse is when they say that he's going to play, you put him on your lineup, and then he gets you 2 catches for 12 yards.
That was me last week.
There's nothing worse than that. And we said that. I mean, we said that was a possibility, but I still think that when Calvin Johnson's playing, when he suits up, it's so hard to sit him, because we've seen situations before where they say he's not fully healthy, and then he goes out there and he just balls out because he's Calvin Johnson.
Yeah, I think if you have a reliable option, like, just for example myself, I have Jeremy Maclin in the league that I also own Calvin Johnson, and I'm playing Jeremy Maclin over him this week, and I'm not even going to pay attention to it.
Who's your other receiver in that league?
Emmanuel Sanders.
Okay, because I think Emmanuel Sanders is ranked lower than Jeremy Maclin.
And what do you mean, on mine?
I mean, in terms of, like, their overall value, in my opinion. I mean, like, from on a week-to-week basis, opposition aside, let's say, just like a base ranking of the two players, I think right now Jeremy Maclin might be ranked slightly higher than Emmanuel Sanders.
They're both very comparable.
Point being, though, you're in a much better situation than most people are.
Oh, yeah,
they
absolutely.
Have Calvin Johnson.
I mean, I have good receivers in that league. Yeah, I mean, if you have a guy like Eddie Royal or something, though, I still might for this week. I mean, it'd be tough, but... Again, after seeing Calvin drop a 3 on you or 2 on you last week, whatever it was, I mean, that's just unbearable. Yeah. And if it's coming down to game time decision again, I mean, I know it's most of the time we preach start your studs no matter what, but it's a matter of start your studs, okay, but, you know, running back still getting the carries just kind of hurts. Like, Calvin was just a decoy. He basically didn't play. So if that happens again, then there's not even a point.
The other concern here is that Golden Tate is not going to play.
No, he is. He's probable.
Oh, he is probable? Excuse me. I'm sorry. So Golden Tate is going to play.
Golden Tate is going to play. He's probable.
So now we look at that situation, and it's like, okay, so if he's going to play, we have somebody that's going to get targeted a lot.
Yeah.
Right? Yep. So, you know, when you see that kind of a situation, obviously Calvin Johnson is not going to be relied on quite as much.
Yeah.
So, I mean...
They paid him money. They brought him in. You assume it'd be for a situation... You know, not only just to play across from Calvin when he's there, but to also assume some of the workload for games that not when Calvin's hurt necessarily, but when teams are just like, yeah, we're triple teaming Calvin, beat us otherwise.
Yeah, right.
You know, they brought him for a job like that, so this might be a prime example to show why they bought him.
So what do you do with Golden Tate this week? I mean, are you starting him in your standard 12-team leagues? I mean, is he a guy who you think is like a top 25 receiver this week?
So this week, yeah, absolutely. Okay. He's playing the Bills. I mean, the Bills are going through some stuff right now with Kyle Orton, EJ Manuel getting benched.
They're an average defense.
Yeah,
I think
they haven't been amazing this year by any stretch of the imagination. Even though they do have talented players, their safety play hasn't been that good this year. I definitely would start Golden Tate, especially considering I think that the Lions will be without Joique Bell as well, too, so it's another mouth that they won't have to feed for this game. Right. I think it bodes really well for Golden Tate to have a really, really nice week in fantasy this week.
Let me run through a couple of guys for you that I want to question you about specifically as far as who would you potentially start this kind of a guy ahead of a Calvin Johnson this week, just okay. Given the fact that we know that Calvin Johnson is in the situation that he's in.
Right.
And if you're in a situation where you have Calvin Johnson and maybe one of these guys, what do you do with these guys? So let me just run through them here. Reggie Wayne at Baltimore. Are we starting Reggie Wayne at Baltimore over Calvin Johnson this week?
Is that game in Baltimore? I thought it was in Indy.
Or no, excuse me. It's in Indy. Excuse me. Yes, in Indy.
Yeah, I probably am.
Okay.
But I mean, you got to keep in mind, though, in my head, I'm on the mindset that game time decision is bad news, and generally that means mm-hmm. he's going to be like 20% healthy at the very best. Because they're saying there's not progress, he won't even play. So I'm basically saying 20% of Calvin Johnson and Reggie Wayne. So I'm going with Reggie Wayne.
Okay, fair. Let's see here. The other guys that I wanted to ask you about specifically, because I wrote these down in preparation for the fact that you were going to dislike Calvin Johnson this week. So let's see here. We've got the other guys I want to mention. Wes Welker versus Arizona.
Yeah.
Wes Welker coming back. You know, he caught 6 passes, 60 yards last week. Are we starting him over Calvin?
Are we considering just standard 12 teams that you said?
Yeah, standard scoring, not so specifically not PPR, any scoring system.
If it's not in PPR, I mean, you know, again, I probably am just because still think there's – I mean, Wes Welker had a lot. How many TDs did Welker have last year and he still missed games? Well, like 10?
Oh, gosh. Early in the year, he was leading the league.
Yeah.
And then it kind of trailed off. So
I mean, standard is so much about TDs a lot of times. So, yeah, I think there's a good chance he catches a TD this week.
Okay.
But yeah, I'd probably go Wes Welker.
How about DeSean Jackson versus Seattle?
Ooh, no. See, that's where I draw the line. That's where I'm taking the shot on 20% of Calvin Johnson.
Yeah, I pretty much agree with that. And then the last one that I wanted to ask you about, let's say head-to-head we have Marcus Wheaton at Jacksonville over Calvin Johnson.
Oh, man. You know, and you know me, I like Marcus Wheaton more than most people do. So, yeah, I'm probably going Marcus Wheaton. Because Ben Roethlisberger's looked really good this year. I mean, you expect, again, I mean, you never know. We thought Tampa would be a blowout too, but we expect that to be a pretty game that's out of reach fairly early. So I could definitely see Marcus Wheaton taking the top off the defense or something with a deep ball and catching a TD. So yeah, I'd probably start Marcus Wheaton too.
Okay, so let's talk about the other part of that game, the running back situation. We talked about that Joique Bell is going to be out this game.
Yeah.
How much does that move Reggie Bush up on your list? I mean, does he move from being a guy who's like a borderline starter to being a potential like top 10 running back this week?
I don't know about top 10, but I'm definitely going to start him in most leagues. I mean, I can't think of a situation where I wouldn't start him. Like I said, I still think the Bills' defensive line has a lot of talent. It still has Mario Williams, Kyle Williams, Marcel Darius, Brandon Spikes behind him. You know, they have some very good defenders versus the run. So Reggie Bush obviously gives you the upside value in, you know, receptions and stuff too. But in a straight running matchup, I still don't think Buffalo is a great matchup for any running back. So even with Joique being out, Reggie Bush is going to see all the carries. You know, he'll see the vast majority, probably like an 80-20 split, but...
Right.
With, I don't know, whoever the backup is. Theo Riddick, I think, is the backup.
Theo Riddick's out as well.
Oh, is he out too?
Yeah, so, I mean, it's real thin this week in Detroit. I mean, I see a situation where Reggie Bush is going to be on the field for probably 90% of the snaps.
I mean, with Theo Riddick being out too, you could certainly see it. Yeah, I mean, he's probably real borderline top 10, just off the top of my head, thinking of who's out there this week. But real, I mean, you can make the case. If someone said he's top 10, I wouldn't be like, oh, you're out of your mind.
Let me ask you this. You starting Reggie Bush or Zach Stacy at Philadelphia?
Oh, that's a good one.
I mean, standard scoring, maybe that helps out Zach Stacy a little bit, but in PPR,
I'm still going Reggie Bush. I don't like Zach Stacy.
I mean, just to give you an idea, Zach Stacy is listed as ESPN.com's number 10 running back for the week.
Where's Reggie Bush?
Reggie Bush is ranked number 15 for them.
And
I think that Reggie's a little too low there.
Yeah, that's silly.
So yeah, let's move on now and let's answer some of these questions that we got from YouTube and Twitter. If you guys have any questions for us about this week's games, make sure that you leave those in the comment section below. We won't be recording another podcast prior to the games, but I will try to answer as many of them through the YouTube comments as I can. Also, if you want to tweet them to us at Project KSL or at Clickwood TV, we will do our best to answer them for you prior to this weekend's games. And of course, if you have questions about trades or anything like that that we can potentially work into the show, we will do our best to answer those on our next podcast, which should be out, I think, probably Tuesday.
Yep.
So let's go into the questions. The first one comes from Mr. James the Gamer on YouTube, and he wants to know, do I start Julian Edelman or Emmanuel Sanders this week? Sanders is at home, but against the Cardinals. And if you're unaware, Julian Edelman is up against the Bengals. Dustin, who do you have this week?
Emmanuel Sanders, and it's not even close. Yeah. I mean, Emmanuel Sanders has been an absolute stud. I mean, he's just been obnoxiously good. And even when Wes Welker came back last week, he still just had a monster game versus Seattle.
Right.
He had a huge game. So, yeah, right. I mean, I think he's pretty much matchup-proof in that offense with Peyton Manning. I mean, he proved it. He had his worst matchup all week, and he was still, what do you have, like a 20? He had just an absurd
monster game.
Monster game for him.
Julian Edelman, I think, is easily the most consistent player in the New England offense. Might even be the only player that, other than Gronkowski, the only player in the offense that I'm starting on a week-to-week basis.
Yeah.
But for this week, if you have the option of him or Emmanuel Sanders, and just about every week, I'm going Emmanuel Sanders, unless it's a particularly amazing matchup for some reason for Julian Edelman. But you have to keep in mind, though, like Dustin said, Emmanuel Sanders already played the toughest matchup that he could possibly play on the road in Seattle, and he put up a monster game.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
it's got to be Emmanuel Sanders. It's not that close.
It's Emmanuel Sanders almost every single week, unless Julian Edelman's up against like a Jacksonville or something like that, and I don't think they're on New England's schedule.
Yep.
So, I mean, you're pretty much starting Emmanuel
Sanders
every
week. Even then,
it depends
who Emmanuel Sanders is playing, and I'm still probably going to play Emmanuel Sanders. So.
Yep, me too, most likely. So, and this is a good example of a possibility that you might want to consider trying to move Julian Edelman just because you're in such a good situation with your wide
receivers. And his value is still probably pretty high right now, too.
Exactly.
He's had some good games despite the fact that Tom Brady's been a piece of shit. So
right, yeah. And that's not saying we don't like Julian Edelman. It's just you have a much better option with Julian.
No, I mean
Emmanuel
Tom
Sanders.
Brady playing like shit plays into Julian Edelman's hand too, which I mean not
exactly
in Tom Brady's hand because Tom Brady can't throw past 5 yards anymore. So
exactly. All right. So next question is from Kevin H on YouTube, and he wants to know who should I start this week: Eli Manning versus Atlanta, Colin Kaepernick versus Kansas City, or Nick Foles versus St. Louis. What do you have?
I'm probably going Nick Foles because we talked about this in the other one we did, that I think that offense is going to get back on track this week. St. Louis is a train wreck, and I like that matchup for Nick Foles, especially at home. Coming back, they just lost their first game of the season. I like that. Eli Manning's a close second, though, with how bad Atlanta's offense or defense has been, and how much better the Giants' offense has been looking recently. So I think it's close with Foles narrowly edging him out.
I like Eli Manning this week, first, and then Nick Foles second. Colin Kaepernick is a pretty distant third. Not that we are that worried about the Kansas City defense, but Colin Kaepernick just hasn't produced fantasy numbers yet this year.
And those other guys are way ahead of him for the time being. Yeah.
Eli Manning put up big numbers this past week. Atlanta's defense just got torn up by the Vikings the last time. So, I mean, like, we're not overly worried about Atlanta's defense. They have no pass rush whatsoever, and that's really what the Giants' biggest weakness has been so far, protecting Eli Manning. So I don't really worry that much about that this week. I love Eli Manning's weapons that he has in that offense, especially with Larry Donnell breaking out. Odell Beckham's potentially going to play maybe this week. So, I mean, there's some definite...
The one thing that made me not want to pick Eli was I really think Rashad Jennings gets it going again this week. I think they're just going to feed him the ball and get it going against the Atlanta defense. It's just been grinded on against the running game. Just destroyed them.
True. And if he gives up, or if he gets another 30 carries again, then obviously that's a tough game for Eli probably. But
yeah.
I still think there's going to be enough points to go around that Eli throws at least 2 TDs in this one.
Oh, yeah, I could definitely see that. And Jennings gets a TD in 100 yards, too, because fuck it,
right.
Why not? Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you could easily see. I mean, that if that happens, that's only 21 points out of the offense, just out of touchdowns. So, I mean, if they kick two field goals, that's 27. I mean, I think that's almost low for them this week. I mean, I really think that they're in the 30s this week scoring-wise, so I like the chances of Eli to get 3 touchdowns in this one. Not that I don't like Nick Foles, but their offense looked really, really brutal. Now, granted, it was against a much better defense in San Francisco than
they're
playing this week.
Let's calm down a little bit, hating on the Eagles all of a sudden.
I'm not hating on them, but, I mean, any time that an offense literally doesn't score points on offense for an entire game, I'm worried about that.
I know, but I think it's just been one game. The offenses look good, the other three.
It has. Yeah. Fair. But I like Eli's matchup this week. On a week-to-week basis, I'm still probably going with Nick Foles, but I just particularly like this matchup for Eli.
Yeah.
So let's move on to the next one. We have Why Not Rhyme. He's asking the question from YouTube, and he says, Jesus Christ, who do I start, Cam Newton versus Chicago or Austin Davis at Philadelphia? I mean, it's gotten to this point, man. It's so sad that it's gotten to this point, but honestly, like, I mean, although I'm going to say Cam Newton again here, it's just going based off of, like, history.
Name.
I mean, Austin Davis has flat out outplayed him in the games that they've both played. So,
yeah,
I mean,
the thing is, yeah, I think you got to go Cam Newton. I mean, he has a good matchup this week. Chicago's defense is piss poor, too.
They so are.
You would hope that if there's a game that he can kind of potentially get back in, you know, in positive minds of fantasy owners, it'd be this week. Chicago is just putrid on defense, so
they are.
You would hope it'd They're be this bad. Week, and just on that alone, because you took him higher, you're invested more in Cam Newton in most scenarios.
Yep.
You throw him out there, if he shits on you this week, then you really consider moving him or whatever you got to do with Cam Newton by at this point. But this is 1 week that I'm going to ride on Cam Newton.
Yep, I agree. Austin Davis looked better than what we expected him to, obviously. He is announced as the starter for the remainder of the year, so keep him on your roster. And, you know, I mean, maybe it ends up that he ends up being the guy that you start from week to week. Just, I mean, you never really know at this point. Yeah. You never really know with Cam Newton. So, tough situation for you, but good luck. Next question, Sal Kicks Butt wants to know, Joe Flacco at Indianapolis or Nick Foles at St. Louis? Another Nick Foles question. Yeah. I'm going to go with Foles here.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, without question. I mean, I liked him better than Eli, and I like Eli's matchup better than Flacco, so.
Sure. And I like Eli better than Flacco. I mean, same reasons. Quarterback.
Yeah, same reasons we already talked about with for Nick Foles. Yeah, it's a good matchup for him coming off. You know, we already talked about all this yada yada. It's Nick Foles over Joe Flacco.
Yep, agreed. Nick Foles over Joe Flacco. Next question comes from Colton Fruling on YouTube. He asks, do I start Antonio Gates versus the New York Jets or Delanie Walker versus the Carolina Panthers, standard scoring league?
God, how sad is that? Just a few weeks ago, we were talking about Gates being so good. Here we are.
I know. He had that one monster game, and we all bought into it. It seems to happen every year with him, man, where he puts up just a huge game.
I wasn't that into him. I got to be honest. I was kind of still just like, eh. You know, I mean, ass go out there, get trotted out, and not do shit for weeks on weeks at a time. Mm-hmm. So
the tough thing is that tight end this year is just such a barren wasteland outside of just the very, very top guys that it's just like, who the hell knows on a week to week basis with these guys. But Delanie Walker right now he's the best fantasy player in Tennessee.
Oh yeah, without
question. That's like saying a whole lot, because Tennessee might be the worst team in the league right now, other than maybe Jacksonville.
Well,
but
I was like Jacksonville, Oakland, they're worse. Jacksonville, Oakland.
Oakland almost beat it, almost won a game. Like
the Titans won a game already, though.
Yeah, they did. They did go in and whip the crap out of the Chiefs.
They
whipped
the shit out of the Chiefs in Kansas City.
Funny is that? But yeah, okay. So I'm gonna go with Delanie Walker this week, just because I think that he's gonna get more targets this week. The Jets' pass defense really isn't that good, but Antonio Gates has been just so meh, and Delanie Walker's been pretty damn good.
I think just wild hair. I think Gates catches a TD this week because the Jets' secondary is so piss poor. So based on that alone, Jake Locker's coming back. We have no idea what percent he could be at. He could just be terrible as he sometimes is. I shouldn't say sometimes, as he usually is. So I have more faith in Phillip Rivers than Jake Locker. I think it's a good matchup for Antonio Gates. If he catches a random TD this week, I think it'll be – if he catches a random TD soon, I think there's a good chance it's this week. I pick Antonio Gates.
Fair enough. I like Delanie Walker's chances of scoring a touchdown this week against Carolina as well. So
yeah, they both have good – as crazy as it is, I mean, Carolina's defense, you assume it would be a good matchup. But Carolina's
really
defense
not.
Also has talent still there. You know, yeah. I mean, Thomas Davis, Luke Kuechly, Charles Johnson. There's players on that defense. So – if there is, and they also just shut down Stafford and the Lions not that recently, even though they did get dumped on by the Steelers and who was the other team? The Ravens annihilated them.
Yeah.
But I think that Jake Locker is going to go in there, drop another shitter, and then who knows. But I think that the Jets are probably, I mean, the Chargers are probably going to win. Gates has a good chance to catch a TD. I'd pick Antonio Gates.
All right. Next question comes from Vince Wilspoon on YouTube, and he wants to know, I got offered Calvin Johnson and Reggie Bush for me to give up LeSean McCoy. This is a no-brainer for me to accept, right?
PPR?
Doesn't say. I don't think it particularly makes that much of a difference.
On PPR, Reggie Bush's value is higher. I mean, LeSean McCoy is probably the same, but it's even a better trade if it's in PPR. So.
True. And yeah, Calvin's is probably a little bit better.
Yeah, Calvin's definitely better because he's, you know, receivers in PPR, obviously. But, yeah, no, I'd probably do it. It's tough because Calvin with the foot, I mean, with his ankle, excuse me, again, you hope they give him a week off and he gets healthy and he's right for the year. But if we play this bullshit, you know, game time decision thing for the next 6 weeks, it's maybe not that good of a trade. It all comes down to what happens with his injury, you know, because he's hurt. LeSean McCoy's not hurt. LeSean McCoy's just underperforming. So,
and we need to know, I mean, the other thing too that we're really banking on here is how long Joique Bell is potentially going to be out. Because
it's only a concussion, isn't it? Like, I can't imagine
it is,
being that long.
But concussions can really vary very greatly.
Yeah.
You get the situations where it's like, I mean, a lot of times if a guy is going to if he's going to be totally fine, he doesn't miss any games. So when he does miss a game, to me, that's a pretty big flag that they're putting up. So I think Reggie Bush could potentially be this team's starting running back. I mean, not just starting, but I mean, like, getting the majority of the carries for at least the next 2 to 3 weeks.
Yeah.
And that alone might make this trade a lot better. So I like Reggie Bush and Calvin Johnson for LeSean McCoy. LeSean McCoy, really, like Dustin said, is underperformed. You're getting still quality players in return here. You're not getting crap. So, I mean, Calvin Johnson obviously has the potential to be literally the number one wide receiver, potentially one of the top overall scorers in all of football going forward if he gets healthy. So
yeah, you're not getting a bad deal. I just, like I said, I've seen some people say they expect Joique back for next week.
Yeah.
But, I mean, with a concussion, it is kind of hard to just know exactly when he would come back, you know?
Yeah. If he's not cleared this week, you never know.
Yeah, that's exactly it. I remember, I mean, Eddie Lacy's had 2 concussions in 2 years, and he's missed, like, a game. You know, yeah, Welker's exactly. One of people, he's missed games. Welker's had a shitload
Percy
of
Harvin.
Percy Harvin's another one. Guy. It varies, so. Yeah. It really just varies. So if Joique's back next week, Reggie Bush's value is in his eye. But still, I probably would do that trade.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, I agree, too. Let's do that trade. Make it happen. I mean, unless you're in a situation where your running backs are going to be like Reggie Bush Doug Martin going forward.
Trades
I don't
are
like
so
that.
team specific. That's the thing. Yeah.
But in a bubble, we like that trade.
Right.
So, all right. Next one. This one's going to be hilarious. You're going to love this one, Dustin. Should I drop Tom Brady to pick up Andy Dalton?
Oh, God. Yeah. No. Yeah. You don't even think twice. Yeah, Tom Brady's trash. Andy Dalton's better. You do it. You don't even worry about it.
It's so sad because I love Tommy Smiles, but yeah, you got to do it. You got to pick up Andy Dalton.
You know, you're a Cowboys fan. You're a fan of Tony Romo. You like garbage quarterbacks. You know what can I say?
Okay. All right. CR Kelly Fly from YouTube wants to know, in a PPR league, can I trade any of the following for Andrew Hawkins? Larry Fitzgerald, Trent Richardson, Donald Brown, or Kendall Wright? So he is apparently he has a standing offer from this person that he can give up any of those four players for Andrew Hawkins. My personal opinion is you give up any of them other than Larry Fitzgerald right now.
I do Donald Brown. I do Kendall Wright. You know, the thing is like I want to say Trent. I want to say Larry Fitzgerald. But again, it's week four or it's week five now. Excuse me. And I still think that if you drafted those guys where you drafted them, you kind of just got to wait it out a little bit longer for more to get more than a guy like Andrew Hawkins. Who isn't going to finish as a top 10 receiver or anything like that? It's just, I think
he's a solid week to week PPR guy.
Yeah, but he's not much more than that. And I think Larry Fitzgerald still, you know, Palmer gets his arm right or whatever, he'd be how much more than that. Trent Richardson, obviously, I know Trent Richardson is terrible, but Ahmad Bradshaw is so injury prone. And if he goes down, they're going to, all the Ahmad Bradshaw carries and everything else, you'd assume would go to Trent Richardson by default because Donald Brown isn't there anymore. So his value could peak just by default if and when Ahmad Bradshaw gets hurt. So I'd still hang on to him for that reason. And I just I don't know. I give him Kendall Wright, though, because he just has not looked like Kendall Wright this year. The Titans just look dreadful. I'd do that in a heartbeat.
You know what's funny is Kendall Wright's one of the guys that is the only guy on this list that I was debating on. Because Larry Fitzgerald, I still
so
think.
Bad.
Look, though, I get it. Right. Larry Fitzgerald. Here's the thing about Larry Fitzgerald. He's going to be better when Carson Palmer gets back. Larry Fitzgerald is, in my opinion.
Everyone on Arizona offense will get an upgrade with Carson Palmer.
So I know Larry Fitzgerald. I mean, I came into the season, Michael Floyd was ranked ahead of Larry Fitzgerald on my list, and a lot of people disagree with that, but I like Michael Floyd better at this point in their careers. I still think Larry Fitzgerald has that potential to have a solid season, though. You know, near 1,000 yards, maybe 7 touchdowns, something like that. He's going to need to pick up the pace, though, but
yeah,
I think once Palmer gets back, that's going to happen.
Fitzgerald started off slow last year, too, and people were saying, oh, Fitzgerald's cooked, and he had that stretch of, like, 6 games towards the end of the season. He just was a good starter damn near every week.
Yeah.
So, like, he still has that in him, and it's just he's not going to be the most consistent guy, but I don't think Andrew Hawkins really is either. But I really don't think with Jake Locker or Charlie Whitehurst, Kendall Wright has much chance of that at all. I mean, last year he had that season where he had damn near 100 catches, but he just does not look good this year.
The Kendall Wright situation to me comes down to, like, I don't really think that it matters that much who their quarterback is. I mean, like, obviously, if they had a great quarterback, we would like him more. But it's not like okay, so they swap up this guy to this guy.
Is the thing.
Really fair. But what I'm trying to say, though, is, like, I don't think Ryan Fitzpatrick is a significantly better quarterback than any of the guys that they have currently in Tennessee.
Well, I mean,
significantly
proven
better.
Otherwise, right? Yeah, dude. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Ryan Fitzpatrick
better, sure.
Look at what he's doing in Houston. Look at what he's doing in Houston right now, DeAndre Hopkins and stuff.
DeAndre Hopkins is a baller.
Yeah, well, sure, you can say what you want, but I mean, I think Justin Hunter's pretty good, too. I think Kendall Wright was pretty good last year, too. I don't think those guys are all of a sudden bad players.
I don't
I'm
either.
Saying, but I think Ryan Fitzpatrick is serviceable enough to at least just understand, get the ball in your playmaker's hands, and Jake Locker and Charlie Whitehurst have not shown that. So I do think they're an upgrade.
Fair enough. I mean, I think he is too, but I mean, like, to me, I look at it and it's like, okay, Kendall Wright's going to make his money at like 5 to 10 yards down the field. If you're an NFL quarterback and you can't throw the ball 5 to 10 yards, what the hell are you doing out there?
Yeah, look at Tim Tebow, Jake Locker, you know those guys.
Well, Tim Tebow is
Jake Locker has serious accuracy issues.
He does.
He has really bad accuracy.
And that could be something that we. I mean, I could end up being completely wrong on this.
Level accuracy issues.
Okay. my point that I'm trying to make here, though, is Andrew Hawkins for Kendall Wright, I kind of think is a wash. I don't really think there's a significant difference between the two.
Ask yourself this. What team do you think has more wins at the end of the season?
Cleveland. Well, I mean, we talked about this earlier. This is the one game that we disagreed on. I actually think Tennessee might squeak out a win here over Cleveland.
Okay, fair enough. Who do you think has more at the end of the season?
I think probably Cleveland, okay. But...
And what quarterback do you like more for the rest of the season? Brian Hoyer or whatever asshole Tennessee tries.
Well, I think Johnny Manziel will eventually play for them.
Well, Hoyer's looked good this season, though, is what I'm trying to say. I think they're on pace for a better team.
When they lose this game this week to Tennessee, we're going to hear comments for Johnny Manziel. Let's just put it that way.
But I think you make comments no matter what. The point is Hoyer, for fantasy purposes for this, has played well.
Fair enough.
He has played well, and he's
given the lack of weapons they have, and yeah.
Yeah, he's gotten the ball to Andrew Hawkins. There's not Josh Gordon coming through the door anytime soon. So I think that he's better than Kendall Wright going forward by like.
I think so too. I don't know if I'd call it significant. I think they're pretty marginally different. But and then like I said, Trent Richardson, I am just kind of meh on. I don't really see. I mean, you mentioned the Ahmad Bradshaw thing. Ahmad Bradshaw could go down, but then I just kind of look at him as being like a Donald Brown, who's also involved in this trade potentially. Where like, okay, so he's the starter. What does that really mean?
Well, the thing is, it might be. I mean, Donald Brown. Even if Brian Matthews is out for the year, I'd hang on to Donald Brown over Andrew Hawkins too. But.
Right.
Because it's just a starting running back, because it's only a 3-week rental. But I think Trent Richardson, he's not losing that job if Ahmad Bradshaw goes down. They're too invested.
Yeah, for a season ender.
Right.
But if Ahmad Bradshaw's out, or, you know, he's got an ankle injury that's keeping him, you know, kind of on the field, you're just in that brutal situation where you think that Trent Richardson's actually startable and he's not.
Well, Ahmad Bradshaw has serious neck issues. You know, that's the thing. True. Ahmad Bradshaw has had multiple season-ending injuries.
True.
Like, it's a trend with him.
So, fair enough. I mean, I think our point here, though, is that most of these guys you're making the trade for Andrew Hawkins for.
Yeah, the vast majority of those guys. Yeah.
So, yeah. All right. So we like that. I mean, we agree, though, on like Donald Brown, right?
As far as what? Trading him?
Yeah. Trade Donald Brown for Andrew Hawkins.
Trade Kendall Wright.
If you can get that, let's do that. I mean, we both agree on Donald Brown. So let's say, you know, given that you have your choice. Okay, but we both agree Donald Brown is a guy you can trade for Andrew Hawkins. Yeah. So that's where we're going to agree on this one. Brandon Conti on YouTube wants to know, should I trade my LeSean McCoy and Cordarrelle Patterson for Le'Veon Bell and Sammy Watkins? Watkins was my buy low earlier this week, and I'm loving this trade.
Yeah, that's a
if
very
I'm getting Le'Veon
too,
Bell.
Le'Veon Bell's he's stud.
Straight up, we're redrafting right now, taking Le'Veon Bell over LeSean McCoy. I'm taking Sammy Watkins over Cordarrelle Patterson. It's a double upgrade for you. I love
it. Me too. No-brainer.
Moving on.
Yep.
Moving on. All right. Next question comes from at bbud10029. And this one's kind of confusing because he actually has three of the best tight ends in fantasy football on his roster. He wants to know, should I give up Vernon Davis, Darren Sproles, and Wes Welker to get Julio Jones? And he also says that he has Rob Gronkowski and Jimmy Graham on his roster, if that makes a difference. So, again, should I give up Vernon Davis, Darren Sproles, and Wes Welker for Julio? Dustin, your thoughts.
Vernon Davis, Wes Welker, and Darren Sproles.
Yep.
And he didn't say one player. PPR?
So you didn't say standard. If it's PPR. No.
I mean, so that's
I'm
going to
assume it is, but
it's tough
knows?
Being in that sort of a situation because I think just because specifically because he has those tight ends are expendable to him, but I would want more to give up those three players because I still think those players are all very startable players in most leagues, you know, week to week, all three, and you're only getting one player. Granted, it's the best player in the trade, but you're giving up three good players to get him.
Mm-hmm.
I think you'd be better off maybe trying to package out separate deals and get more talent in return than just offering a 3-for-1. Because you're not offering one good player, two duds. You're giving away three good players. Darren Sproles might be the weak link of the three, crazy that sounds. And you're only getting one back one player. So,
fair enough.
I don't know.
I think Julio Jones, like you said, is pretty clearly the best player in this trade. If we're redrafting right now, I think Julio Jones is a borderline first-round pick. And I always say that if we're redrafting, and the reason that I say that is because What you have to look at in fantasy football is not just what they've done so far, but what you expect them to do for the remainder of the year. And I think Julio Jones is at the point where we look at him and he's put up baller numbers so far. There's no reason to think that that won't continue. And if you're redrafting right now, you take Julio Jones at the end of the first round. Whereas all these other guys, Vernon Davis, Darren Sproles, Wes Welker, yeah, we're talking about them as being like fifth, sixth, seventh round picks. So, I mean, to me, you're giving up three mid-round picks for a guy who's arguably the number one wide receiver going forward.
Yeah.
Gotta love it. I mean, to me, I love that trade, especially given the fact that you're deep at tight end. So Vernon Davis is pretty much a throw-in for you. Now, what I will say is if you have Rob Gronkowski and Jimmy Graham rostered right now, you need to be moving Rob Gronkowski.
Yeah,
because I completely agree. If you're in a league where, obviously, I'm assuming here that there's a mandatory tight end position, like most leagues are. So, and that you didn't just go out and draft. I mean, but that's kind of what happens, though, is there's a lot of these leagues where, for whatever reason, you don't have a mandatory tight end, and there's one owner that goes out and drafts five tight ends, and then they're like, oh, I have all the best tight ends. Well, congratulations, you have, like, the number, like, 15-ranked wide receiver, because that's really what they become, right? I mean, other than Jimmy Graham and maybe Julius Thomas, but, like... Yeah. So for this, if we're assuming that there is a tight end position here, Rob Gronkowski to me is still at a very premium at the tight end position because there aren't a lot of quality starters at tight end this year. I mean, other than like your Julius Thomas and your Jimmy Graham, there really isn't anybody that has shot up significantly. Larry Donnell has been very good, but I mean, I don't think you're necessarily taking him over Rob Gronkowski. So
I
like
the rest of the year.
Yeah, I mean, you could certainly argue it. I mean, I think we talked a little bit about that prior to when we recorded this podcast. I mean, I think it's closer than people imagine it would be. Yeah. But my point is, though, is that the perception is Rob Gronkowski still Rob Gronkowski. He has three touchdowns in four games. So, I mean, production-wise, he's been kind of what you expect him to be, a tight end touchdown monster. And there's no reason to think that that won't continue. So, Rob Gronkowski, if you can trade him for a quality wide receiver or a quality running back, let's say, like, for example, that you could get a... I'm just trying to think here. Like, let's say, hypothetically, you could trade Rob Gronkowski for a Victor Cruz going forward. Would you do that? Because I would.
Yeah. No, yeah, absolutely. And, I mean, yeah, without question.
I mean, going into the year, Rob Gronkowski is probably getting drafted above Victor Cruz. And, I mean, they both produced decently but not spectacularly. But, I mean, you want to make an upgrade at some of these positions. Whereas you're currently sitting here with three tight ends on your roster, Vernon Davis, Gronkowski, and Graham, who are all quality starters. Now, unfortunately, Vernon Davis has had this string of injuries, and that's made him basically useless. But, I mean, hypothetically, he comes back. He's going to be another top five.
He'll be a top five tight end. Walk
type
right into
eight,
it,
maybe, at the very, very worst tight end. So he's a startable tight end for the remainder of the year. And he has a name, too. Vernon Davis is a name everybody knows.
Yeah.
So you'd love to have that for trade purposes, obviously. But like Dustin said, man, I mean, I think that you can potentially do, you know,
you
potentially
can do better
package
that.
Something else to get Julio Jones or another receiver. But in a bubble, I do like this trade.
Just given the fact that we're getting
that first-round player.
If it's straight up yes or no, this trade is either you're doing it or you don't, yeah. But I'd try to do other trades before I'd accept that one if it was just me.
I'd like to float Rob Gronkowski out there and maybe, like, Rob Gronkowski and Darren Sproles together and see what I can get in return. Or Rob Gronkowski and Wes Welker. Let's float those two guys out there and see if we can get a better trade. And I'm not saying a better trade. I mean, like, maybe you could get... Now, let me put it like this. If you were doing Rob Gronkowski and Darren Sproles, do you like that trade better for Julio than
Vernon, absolutely. Sproles, without question.
And Welker?
Yeah, without question.
I do too. So, to me, I would try and see if you can counter him with that. If you can do that, I would do that trade. If not, though, I'd still go ahead and do this trade. Keep Jimmy Graham on your roster, though. Don't worry about it. Start him every single week, no matter the matchup. All right, so our final segment of this podcast is going to be something we do every single week, which is our busts and our sleepers of the week. So busts of the week are players who are typically going to be starters for your fantasy roster, but for this week specifically, we do not like them being in your fantasy roster, or in your starting lineup, I should say. So, Dustin, who is your bust of the week this week?
We sort of talked about this matchup a little bit earlier. This week, I think I found a pretty easy one. I picked CJ Spiller. He's at Detroit. Detroit has been ridiculously good versus the run this year. They have monsters on that defensive line.
Yep.
You assume this will be kind of a harder game for Kyle Orton to step right into. The Detroit defense hasn't been no joke this year at all. So it'll be kind of harder. There's still a timeshare there too, which is always just bad in general. But it's a timeshare this week versus a really, really good rush defense. So yeah. I want nothing to do with CJ Spiller this week. I'm exploring all other options. Just to give you some names, I'm 100% starting ahead of him. Kyrie Robinson, Bishop Sankey this week without question. I'm starting all both right. of them.
Love it. I completely agree. CJ Spiller is still the RB2 there.
Yeah.
Flat out.
That's such, so weird. It Marone is. Does not like... They need to move CJ Spiller. They need to trade CJ Spiller to Denver so he can just prosper.
That would be hilarious, but I mean, that honestly though, it's not that
trade.
Outrageous. Right? We
It'd
talked about, trade. You know, what's funny too is we talked about last week on our podcast. I said that the Titan or the Texans should trade Andre Johnson to the Patriots, yeah. And then I heard earlier this week on ESPN somebody was talking about that.
Oh God!
So I'm ahead of the trend.
Getting shot for a trade? Oh, dude, Belichick gonna get him.
Yeah. Well, I don't even think anybody's shopping him for a trade. That I mean, it was just something that we talked about because they just have no downfield options. But and same thing with Denver. They just have no explosion out of the backfield right now. Monty Ball's look like crap. I still believe in Monty Ball, though. I'm still a believer.
For fantasy, fuck him in real life. Yeah.
For fantasy. And that's what we're talking about, guys. When I say some of these guys, it's I don't love them, but, you know, it is what it is. All right. My bust for the week, this week here, week 5, Andre Ellington at Denver. Look, yep. Andre Ellington still dealing with a lingering foot injury. He's still had injuries since the beginning of the season. He's looked meh at best. Still looking for that first touchdown on the year. The Broncos have allowed 3 touchdowns on the ground, but they still haven't allowed any team to rush for 100 yards against them. So yep. this to me doesn't look like a game that you're going to see Andre Ellington out there getting 150 yards of offense and a touchdown. The way that you beat Denver is by passing. And, you know, and you have to really be able to do that. I mean, if you're a team like Arizona, that is, if you're Seattle, it's a little bit different. But, you know, if you're a team like Arizona, you have to be able to pass the football to those big receivers. You have to be able to exploit them.
Yeah, the thing is they're going to make Drew Stanton beat them. It's right. not going to be Andre Ellington rushes for 400 yards or something. Kind exactly. of control. It's going to be ads. Drew Stanton's going to beat them consistently if they win this game.
Right. So to me, I look at this situation and I don't really see a good opportunity for Andre Ellington to touch the ball 20 times. And, you know, if he touches the ball 15 times and he gets 5 yards per carry, I mean, that's an okay game. But unless he sneaks into the end zone, which is unlikely, given what we've seen so far and just the lack of his use at the goal line, you know, it's not a great game.
Yeah.
So to me, I don't love him. I particularly in standard scoring leagues, I don't like Andre Ellington this week. In a PPR, I still think he could, you know, sneak in there as a flex.
I was gonna say as a flex in a PPR, but in a standard, yeah, I'm not playing.
Yeah,
him.
But in a standard scoring league, I mean, like you said, you mentioned some of these guys, Kyrie Robinson. I like Jeremy Hill better than him this week. Bishop Sankey. I like Ben Tate better than him this week at Tennessee.
Yeah.
Ben Tate coming back from an injury. He's been anointed as the starter once again. They've been very clear about that he is going to be their guy going forward. So, you know, I like overall, I do like him a lot better than I like Andre Ellington.
Yeah.
So let's talk about our sleepers of the week. And I want to hear who your sleeper of the week is in week 5.
Again, we sort of talked about his same game, opposite side of the ball, Golden Tate. He's probable.
All right.
I'm not expecting Calvin to play. If Calvin does play, I expect him to be full decoy status again, pretty much. So, yeah.
Plenty of targets.
Yeah, exactly. No Joique Bell. Joique Bell's used heavily in the passing game. And they brought him in to be a guy that can be reliable opposite of Calvin Johnson. So here's your chance. Yep. Golden Tate's not a bad receiver. He's been a good fit for them thus far. I think he has a good matchup this week versus Buffalo. And there's still a lot of places where he's not ranked very high. So I definitely think I'm picking Golden Tate this week. Last week I had Eddie Royal nailed, so let's hope I can go 2 for 2.
All right. Yeah, I like Golden Tate this week as well. This week, I'm looking at Marcus Wheaton at Jacksonville. Now, Marcus Wheaton's caught 4 passes in every game this season, which is pretty damn good for the wide receiver, too, in Pittsburgh. I mean, this is typically going to be a running-first team. I do think Le'Veon Bell is going to be your potentially your number one overall player this week for fantasy.
Yeah,
but I still think there are so many points to go around in this game. Jacksonville is just awful. They're the worst defense in the NFL. They're just a fantasy goldmine. You start everybody pretty much against them every single week. Marcus Wheaton is definitely a guy who's going to get some targets this week. I think that this might be the first game where he steps into the end zone for a touchdown.
Yeah.
So I like the chances this week. Now, he did have a groin injury that limited him early in practice earlier this week, but he did practice fully on Friday, and he should be able to play without much concern this weekend. Jaguars have given up the 2nd most fantasy points to opposing wide receivers this season. I mean, the past two games, I looked it up, 526 yards and four touchdowns allowed to Indianapolis and San Diego wide receivers. And it's not like Indianapolis and San Diego wide receivers are the big rock stars. I mean, they're solid, but they're nothing spectacular. There's no Calvins there. There's no Demarius, no Dez, nothing like that. They're good players. I think that Pittsburgh puts up 35 or more points in this game, which it gives Marcus Wheaton a good opportunity to have a great game this week. Could sneak in, and I like him better in, as a flex play than Andre Ellington. There you go. So, with that being said, that is going to wrap up today's episode. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. We hope you enjoyed it. We hope you learned something. If you did, make sure you press that like button below. And also be sure to press that subscribe button so that you can be updated when we put out our new episode, which will be probably next Tuesday. If you have any questions about your lineup this week, make sure that you leave those in the comment section below. Or, of course, tweet them at us at Project KSL or at ClickwithTV. If you have any general fantasy football questions, we'd love to answer those as well. And we'll do our best to answer those on the next episode. So thank you guys again. Good luck in week five. And we will talk to you guys on Tuesday with our next episode of the Fantasy Football Swagger Podcast.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.